song. I wonder how the earth would take to my bones. Do you wonder what your life would be all alone? Is everything eventually comes to a close? So put your heart in.
Awesome. I'd like to thank you for allowing us into your homes for this 40th edition of Season 3 of Esoteric Science Roundtable. And I want to start with a few brief notices or announcements. First, I want to thank everyone that came out to the metaphysical philosophical meeting that was this past Wednesday that we here at Esoteric Science Roundtable and the fine folks over at 34IM host every third Wednesday of the month at Opal Divines. Also, wanted to mention briefly the intro music is a new release from a friend of mine, Michael Haga, who used to be the frontman for a band called Dead Horse, and this is his new project called The Plus and Minus Show, and I wanted to kind of preview a bit of that for folks. It's very great music, and I just wanted to kind of get that out to the public a little bit as well. Last thing I want to mention briefly, there's an event this Saturday, tomorrow, in Kerrville called the Freedom Jamboree, and that's going to entail a lot of speakers and some music acts. And there are going to be quite a few people. This is in Kerrville from 9 to 9 at the Louise Hay Park. And so I'm definitely going to be checking that out. And I'm glad to be able to be part of the first annual Freedom Jamboree as far as being an attendee. And so look forward to seeing anybody that's going to be planning to make it out that way. Okay, so today I want to start with introducing the guests that I have. First of all, Omega. And we've also got with us Darcy. And Dionysis. Right. And I want to thank you guys. For today's show, I've got custody of the Esoteric Orphans, and the show title that we're going to go with is Cross Currents. Reason being, earlier in the week on Jeff's show, Therefore I Am, you guys spoke pretty much in depth about the Rosicrucian tradition and a lot of history relating to that particular aspect of the esoteric stream. And so I want to kind of take from that esoteric tradition from the Rosy Cross and bring that forward and kind of tie that into some other traditions that have a lot of commonalities, as do all true esoteric orders that have many commonalities, and sort of to take that from that perspective and kind of pull it forward and kind of weave it into a larger context of what's going on in today's esoteric orders. And so as far as from the Rosicrucian tradition, did one of you guys want to chime in initially to kind of get this ball rolling as far as how we're going to...
Well, I did want to, we were speaking a little bit beforehand mm-hmm. about some of the symbols used by the more modern orders, and Dionysus pointed out that a lot of these symbols weren't actually in the original Fama or the Confessio or the Chemical Wedding. So I think we need to be clear about the evolution of the concept or notion of the Rosicrucians mm-hmm. through time. So I don't mean for that to restrict us in any way, but we mm-hmm. do want to remain conscious of where things entered into the stream of thought.
Sure, okay.
So I think that a little bit of historical context, I don't know how you feel about starting a little bit where we left off and just kind of smoothly going into it.
How about the numerical symbolism and the Kabbalistic symbolism that was contained in the original writings? Did you guys want to maybe touch on that a bit and bring that forward? The gematria?
I don't know. I bet you.
Well, and we were just talking about that a little bit. I think it's an interesting... The whole issue of symbolism is really key. After all, a lot of people, even people who have participated very sincerely in the entire Rosicrucian tradition, mm-hmm. Have looked at its genesis as one that was basically legendary and consisted of symbols.
Mm-hmm.
So, part of the issue with Rosicrucianism has to do with the modes of identification and, you know, how do you know if this is really a Rosicrucian order since, you know, for centuries there have been so many Rosicrucian orders and not always in anything like agreement with each other.
And a good point you guys made on Jeff's show as well, that any true Rosicrucian in most cases wouldn't even identify himself as such. And so how are you going to know from that perspective or that angle as well?
Right. Crowley, for example, wrote that the true Rosicrucian uses the true symbols mm-hmm. without calling them Rosicrucian, without attaching the true name thereto. And so that leaves open the question of what are the true symbols?
Would you say that you would have to penetrate into that tradition yourself to know for your own truth what that really is? Or how do you think you would be able to discern what those symbols truly were if you were going to take that particular path?
Let me just interject. Yeah, it might be difficult to find the true tradition, since anyone who claims to be Rosicrucian potentially isn't one. There's some question about how you even would be, you know, enter into the stream.
I was going to end with that as far as the path of the esotericist, but let's begin with that, because that's wonderful. How is it, do you think, that somebody, I mean, because different people are going to find different paths. Certain things are going to appeal to certain people. And you can probably just start to divide that, first of all, by a more Eastern slanted or tinged approach versus a more Western tinged approach to esotericism, kind of a yin to the yang view of how this all shakes out, even though we're looking at one common energy that is interpenetrating both. Tends to be a polarity in a sense.
And what do you mean by East and West? I mean, I know, like, for instance, in the theosophical milieu, you have East means India and Tibet, mm-hmm. and West means... Yeah, the Anglo-American, somewhat the continental, but and maybe even some of the Orient in terms of, you know, Christianity and Judaism as Oriental religions.
Right.
But they're the West in that theosophical framework.
Right,
but if you look at the origins of Rosicrucianism,
yes.
there is, even at the very beginning in the 17th century, there's mm-hmm. this whole idea of the East and the West, where the East is Islam. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've got a situation where the political and economic balance between Christian Europe and the Islamic East is rather delicate, and there are people who are looking for a universal reformation that would comprehend all of this and find a higher human culture, and that seems to have been part of the drive behind the original manifestos.
Okay. And in fact, Persia was considered at a certain point the highlight. I mean, there were many people talking about traveling to Iran. There was a lot of the Iranian sun god kind of
The Babylonian Chaldean culture for sure was at the high point of, you know.
So East may have referred to the old Persian or Iranian. I mean.
But as far as the practice, I guess that would be entailed within those, encompasses within those, because I kind of boil it down to East is more based on a meditative, kind of contemplative, and West more on a more specific physical ritual enactment. And that's how I would delineate the two. That even though the meditation may be considered somewhat passive, it's still a positive meditation. It's still a reaching out and trying to ascertain and gain something. But just the methodology is a bit different. And I think that's where the appeal for how different people are going to line up and, you know, try. When they decide they want to make a path towards some kind of an esoteric whatever endeavor, you know, and what's going to appeal to them, you know, maybe theosophy initially, and there's a wide variety of things available. I want to mention this quickly as well. Back at the turn of the century, two centuries ago, about 1875 and previous to that, you had to be more affluent and you had to be more wealthy to really run in the circles with these societies. In this day and age, with the availability of, like, used books and the internet and things of that nature, and just communication in general, you don't have to be either wealthy or affluent or be well connected to have an esoteric lifestyle or approach or be involved in an esoteric group. And I wanted to really hammer that point home as well. And that's kind of evolved. That's a definite evolution and a positive moving forward, I would feel, from earlier days.
I think there's always been a certain amount of autochthonous mysticism, though. I mean, Jakob Bema is a
he was the original cobbler, theosophist.
You know, I mean, yeah, he was the original lowercase t theosophist, mm-hmm. you know. And he was a cobbler and was not educated and not traveled. And he just kept having these visions and writing these books and inspired whole movements.
But would you put that more in a mystic context or more in an occult context? Because having taking in visions and, you know, that could be a delineation as well, mystic versus occult, the heart versus the head, in a sense.
I don't know if those are, those terms are vague enough in general usage that I don't know that they necessarily are mutually exclusive. Occult was certainly around as an adjective for a long time, just meaning hidden.
Sure.
But we don't have anything called occultism as such until the 19th century. So, I mean, in a way, of course, Bebe was a mystic. He considered himself a mystic. Other people thought he was a mystic because that was the vocabulary available at the time. Mm-hmm. But the traditions that used his visions, I mean, certainly become entangled with and interbred with occultist.
Certainly. And John Dee would probably fall in that category as well, as far as the Enochian so-called magic and what he was able to divine or discern from his, but more of a ritualistic practice in this sense.
And I still would take issue with your sort of
the delineation.
Caricature of East versus West on, on, you know, active versus passive or contemplative versus magical.
Right.
Because if we go to the East, I mean, we can certainly see tantric traditions and Taoist traditions.
Yeah, I'm not saying there isn't ritual involved.
There's plenty of, like, active ritual and goal-oriented, you know, striving practices on the esoteric level.
Good point, And that's why, again, the theme of the show, cross-currents, because there is so much blending, it's really hard to discern any true thread from amongst all the entanglement that's gone on since our human evolution. But I think there are some general delineations that can apply. I agree with you as far as, you know, there can be some graying as well.
I'm disagreeing with you more strongly than that, because I really think that that this preconception of the active West and the passive East is a function of colonialist discourse. You know, it's like we Europeans go conquer a bunch of Asian countries and take their resources because we are active and they are passive. You know, and you can see this going on, within India from the very earliest colonial Indian period through the post-colonial present. There's this constant, like, give and take within Indian culture about, you know, well, are we spiritual and contemplative and superior that way, or are we, you know, or is that just knuckling under to the image that's been pressed on us?
And so you could also argue outsiders. You could argue that India conquered England in many respects as well. So I mean, just the way that the culture, you know, became immersed in the British culture and how there was emerging a crossing of currents culturally as well. But I'm going to get you guys jumping in, please. Darcy, and don't be so silent, man. Step in and give your impressions. Right. Please, maybe from some of the theosophical relations or something along those lines.
Well, to jump back to the Fama Fraternitatis and the confessions.
Please.
There was no symbols in there. They were all kind of described by word. And what a lot of people did is they took the words and built a tradition around.
But can't a word have a value or symbolism?
Yeah, but people that, you know, let's say a rose and a cross, people are going to interpret it differently. That's why there's so many different versions out there.
Sure, sure. And then other orders would integrate other aspects with their rose crosses as well, and further, like we were using the Caduceus earlier. And that can be brought in as
which
adoration or adornment.
Which is cognate to the Rosicrucians. I mean, what text is this? This is Manual of the Church of Illumination. Which is, as we talk about, cognate, because you've got Hermes, the medicine symbol. This is his, you can't see this, it's the caducus.
The winged serpent.
With the serpent.
Right.
And the serpent is intertwined similarly to the Ida and the Pingala of Kundalini Yoga. And you see the symbol used in medicine, which harkens to the Rosicrucians as healers. And so it makes sense that someone would have brought that in. But as Dionysus mentioned, that was a later symbol.
A later adornment specific to one particular.
But it fits in with the Hermetic, Kabbalistic.
Agreed, very much so.
Alchemical thing. And actually, that's one thing I wanted to mention was alchemy. It
Please.
Came to us from what then was called the East. So,
a lot of the texts were written in Arabic.
Okay, gotcha. So that would fall back to the Babylonian, Persian era, Chaldean, perhaps?
I mean, even the Middle Ages. And because those texts came to us after the Crusades.
I was going to bring the Crusades in as well. Okay, so there was certainly a lot of, not just trading of spices and things of that, but we found a lot of esoteric literature that was recovered.
But even back to the active thing, I mean, I wanted to get this point in.
Sure,
in terms of ritual, we'll find a lot of ritual happens with a lot of the later magicians and hermeticists and maybe Rosicrucians using the works of like Abramelin the Mage. So this text is another example
and
of an
the Mage,
active
was he
ritual,
Persian,
which became
according
huge.
According to that legend?
Well, no, Abramelin himself is a Jew.
Okay,
but
right.
He's been taught the sacred magic by a Muslim.
Okay.
And he in turn says,
see, I read that,
that
part, but I forgot
that anyone, you know, he's giving this to his second son.
Yeah, I remember that.
And
it's passing on the tradition.
But you know, he's giving the full instructions, which include the idea that this can be given to someone of any faith.
Right.
But what's important is that they keep the faith with which
they were born. That's right. He was very, very emphasizing of that. I remember that as well.
Which is very, it's a real innovation for the period in magic, because prior to that, almost any magic you find is really tied into whatever its religious context is. It's like, you know, only Christians can do good magic, or only Jews can, like, really use the Kabbalah, or only, you know, it's like, so the cultural and religious context is fixed, whereas with Abramelin, it starts to become relativized. And then, I mean, a tradition that's been extremely influenced by Abramelin, you have the modern Thelemite magicians who all put a priority on this Abramelin type knowledge and conversation with the Holy Guardian Angel. But these people are almost all adult converts to a religion into which hardly anyone is born. You know, it's its own occult religious form. So,
right,
so that has gone like almost full circle to the idea of being proper to a certain religion, but because it's a new religion, it involves it's an even more radical change than the Abramelin was from the previous fixed traditions.
Okay, Darcy, I'd like to ask you then, as far as the traditions becoming more merged and more universal, and bringing it forward from, let's say, 1875 forward, you know, how, can you speak maybe a bit about how the merging of the traditions took place and how the factors of the time, communications and things of that nature, allowed for more of this merging and more sharing of traditions?
Well, Blavatsky, when she founded the Theosophical Society, wanted to merge a lot of the traditions together, like the East and the West, as she perceived it. But what happened was everybody was kind of more interested in the Eastern, you know, from India tradition, and everybody, the Western kind of fell away, and they concentrated more on the Eastern studies.
Would you say everybody was more interested? It seemed like there were two parties, but the Eastern group had more control over what was going on with, so the Westerners kind of like, they had to walk.
Well, I would say that had to do with the adoration of the masters that the Theosophical Society had. If you weren't adoring the masters and that wasn't your full focus, and you were thinking, you know, doing your own little ritualistic thing, well, you were more of a renegade in their overall umbrella perspective. So you had to go underground, I think, to a certain degree.
Well, but so all the masters were, by definition, Eastern?
Well, no.
Well,
if you're Theosophical, I mean, Theosophists, I've been to a Theosophical lodge before, and I try to give these folks benefit of the doubt, but they tend to be very dogmatic. The vast majority of Theosophical people that I've come across tend to be very dogmatic in their approach, and if you don't, like, for instance, if you're not a purist with the Blavatsky tradition, I went to a lodge, and I mentioned this other guy who was, my first introduction to Theosophy was through G.D. Perucker, The Fundamentals of the Esoteric Philosophy, the first book I ever purchased along those lines metaphysically, and it opened my eyes to Theosophy in that tradition. And when I mentioned that to them, they were like, oh, well, you need to go to Altadena. They have a group that meets in Altadena in California that you would want to chat with. So they basically gave me the cold shoulder. And these were older gentlemen for the most part, you know, 60s, 70s, 80s perhaps. And I thought I could, you know, be kind of taken under the wing, so to speak, and be nurtured by this group of gentlemen. You know, I was looking for that from them, some kind of peer group. And, you know, I was new to this information. I was really excited about it. I wanted to find somebody that could, you know, fuel that fire. And I got just the opposite. I got kind of a stop cold. And I realized how dogmatic and how also the Theosophical Society, they don't really do a lot of active, practical things. They're just more like a discussion group. They just get together and discuss the concepts. And some, I guess you could say, live a good moral life according to the precepts of Theosophy. And others, I don't know. It just seems to be more of a discussion club in this day and age, unfortunately. I think it's really lost you know, when the great leaders like Blavatsky and even Besant, lead beater on down the line, when these people passed away, you know, that leadership, that core went with it, I think.
But in its dominant mode, the Theosophical Society has always been a lecture society. That's the way it organizes. There have been ritual and initiatory efforts within the Theosophical matrix, but they've always been a tiny minority of the Theosophists.
But just in the sense of going out and trying to find something active and practical in the world to do, as far as like social work and things, like Besant, she was so active in her day in the social movement, labor movements, as were so many of the Muslim women back in that day, and a lot of the men that were trying to get social reform and be respective of other cultures, races, things of that nature, trying to really look at things as a universal brotherhood, trying to bring that into applicable, you know, activity and expression. And I just see, again, no disrespect really, but a lot of Theosophists just paying lip service to that rather than really living that practically and doing things in their daily lives, their careers, or what have you, to really manifest that more so than just some vague ideal that they discuss from time to time. And that's been my experience, and I wish it were otherwise, but, you know, that's my, and maybe that's a limited approach to the vast, you know, expanse of Theosophy, but that's unfortunately the experience that I've had.
But I know in England, there was a big interest at, for sort of practical occultism, and Yeats, that was a member of the Theosophical Society, tried raising the spirit of a dead flower, and he was asked to leave the Theosophical Society because it was causing discussion. So, but Yeats went on, you know, to become a member of the Golden Dawn.
Like, see, I would
but
say
but
that,
but so. Also, like, if you look at historically, the most of the practical and sort of occult, esoteric type groups were kind of under the male Masons, and that was Westcott that kind of brought together a group that was open for everybody.
Well, I would say that that Masonry, for a lot of the 18th and 19th centuries, tended to monopolize the ritual dimension. When you say like active, I heard you guys talking about two different kinds of activity. I heard Darcy talking about like practical occultism, and I heard Kory talking about like implementation of social ideals.
Like, I'll give a good example. I was watching the Atheist show, I guess, last week, and the girl was saying how she's a social worker, and she's doing so much more than some people that would call themselves whatever their denomination or term they apply to themselves that would lend to some kind of spiritual leanings or belief or something of that nature, that here you have an atheist that's leading a life example that's much more sterling and shining than so many people that I find that refer to themselves as, you know, perhaps Christian or Theosophical or whatever the case may be. And that was more, I guess, you're accurate in that. I think it's more sort of what I was discussing. But your thing is applicable as well.
Yeah, they're both interesting points. I just heard you talking past each other a little.
I think that we have different terms for stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, I think last time, I referred to the Theosophical Society as a theoretical group, and you referred to them, I think, as discussion group?
Corey said discussion group. I said lecture society. Yeah.
I think that's semantics, because I could see those being all synonymous in my
realm. Yeah, those don't seem real different. Mm-hmm. But when you talk about active or practical work, that means something really something really different. If by active and practical you mean doing ceremony in a temple, or active and practical you mean getting out on the street with handbills, or you know, it's like those are very different things.
Right, certainly. And it even goes back to that the multiple threads in Rosicrucianism, where you've got the social utopianism on the one hand, and then you've got the Hermetic Kabbalah ritual on the other.
Because if you're working through an esoteric order and you're expressing ideas of universal brotherhood, you should be living that example at some level. If you're not, then you're short-circuiting the teaching. You're falling short of that high watermark by not living that expression. That's just my opinion, you know.
But some people express their lives in a cave as hermits, and
that's more mystic. That's not, to me. I mean,
to
they
you,
could,
but you don't live in a cave, so you don't have that experience.
I mean, in some instances, I could see somebody, some heavy guru guy, sending out his will, you know, and influencing other
or maybe controlling the world, you know, from his cave. I mean, I just don't want to be dismissive of people who are on a. I mean, the word hermit, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
hermetic, Hermes. I'm cool on that.
I think there's important esoteric value to isolation of various kinds.
I would agree with that.
Formal secrecy, what have you. But it's also true that a lot of people are attracted to occultism and esotericism because they are in an escapist mode.
Right,
and
it's a mystery and it's something, you know.
Or they're already narcissistic, or are they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
and they don't want to challenge that in them, and so they just, like, you know, fall into a comfortable quietude.
Right, play that role out. I could see that.
And the Abermelon is also a seclusion.
Requires solitude.
Oh, yeah, that's kind of a temporary one, right?
Yeah, sure. But you go for
30
6
days.
Months.
Oh, is it 6 months?
6 yeah. months.
Mm-hmm. Ooh. Yeah. See, you can do that in this day and age, I don't think, very practically.
Well, that wasn't easy then either. I mean,
right. It's probably harder then. I mean, you know, you didn't have a convenience store.
Yeah, you couldn't keep food in the freezer.
I thought it was bound to... we're maybe getting a little too deluded with this, but I thought he was bound for 6 months to not even leave his little room.
Yeah, you need an assistant.
Yeah.
Right. So that's
so. Oh yeah, practical occultism. I was referring to true initiation that was introduced by the Golden Dawn, and prior to that, you didn't really have a lot of the like what I perceived as a true initiation, and that is bringing a energy into the lodge room and manipulating that for the individual to raise their consciousness so that they finally reunite themselves with their higher self.
Do you have an opinion, to take another group that's sort of contemporary, a little earlier than the Golden Dawn, the Rosecroix Kabbalistique? Do you have an opinion on why they were not true initiation, or would that maybe be an exception?
I see that the Golden Dawn was very ahead of their time when they introduced the officer forms. They had a god form for them, and that was one of the first groups that actually did that.
So you're saying the quality of the ritual or the initiation?
They brought in the astral temple.
Like the technique, the mechanism itself of initiation was an innovation of the Golden Dawn.
But there were previous initiatory groups, is what you're claiming, certainly.
But they didn't use that innovative technique. Right. Is what Darcy's saying?
I guess. I mean, I guess that seems to be what Darcy's saying.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, yes.
Okay. And I think it might be really difficult as well to truly ascertain who first did some of these certain things.
Certainly. Documentary evidence is not going to be enough.
Yeah, it's not really forthcoming.
You could easily look at a bunch of Golden Dawn materials and not, without if you weren't actually involved, you might not know about how the god forms fit in exactly. And
it could be argued that this all happened in Egypt, that... Actually, the Golden Dawn technology isn't new per se, but a
revamping
of what the Egyptian pharaohs may have gone through.
I would agree with that as well. You could trace the esoteric thread back to the start.
You might not be able to trace the thread back.
Mean, frankly, I think the basic god form concept is right there in Roman Catholic ritual. I mean, you've got the priest when the priest does when he consecrates the host. He takes on the God form of Jesus. I mean, he recites the institution narrative from the Gospels, and then he says, this is my body. It's like, it's a pretty clear...
He replays the last communion.
It's that magical process. And I don't think that it was brand new with the Golden Dawn, although the way that they, hybridized it with some existing Masonic techniques and everything, there was definitely an innovation there.
Also, the congregation doesn't really play a role as much as you would in a pure ritualistic temple setting.
Although, because the congregation, you might say, is not esoterically instructed. However, there are prayers in the Mass.
When it was Latin, especially.
Especially when it was in Latin. Prayers in the Mass that are designed expressly to echo the heavenly host, so that the congregation takes on the
role
of
Christ,
of
I guess.
The angelic choirs or the... and so this is not... I think this is something that happens a lot in various religious forms. And then we have magical orders that are not necessarily religious per se, because they aren't religions in the way that we look at these institutions now, but they have this strong spiritual component that uses these sort of techniques.
Mm-hmm.
So, the other point I was going to make was the ritual that's done prior to that, I saw it as kind of really dry. They were just reenacting a play that the candidate was involved in.
A counterexample I would come up with for that would be Cagliostro's Egyptian Rite, which is, an amazing set of three rituals superimposed on the Masonic craft. And in the third ritual of the Egyptian Rite, they would do full-on spirit evocation, sometimes with a child medium.
Let me ask you this, Cagliostro, wasn't he the one that had the Cagliostro's cabinet or closet or something like along those lines? Is that the same?
Cagliostro's?
Cagliari.
Oh, is that what
Caligari? That's? You're thinking about the cabinet of the Caligari, is a, it's a movie.
Oh, okay.
Okay, never mind. Anyway.
Different game. Okay. But, I mean, this all piques my curiosity because these groups are related with Rosicrucians? Like, either directly or name, or they claim it. I guess the question, and maybe Darcy, you can answer this one, or you could try, or whoever. But I mean, I guess my question is, why does it continue to be relevant? Why do people keep seeking the Rosicrucianism? I mean, who cares? We've got, you can go to church, you can join the Masonic Lodge, you could join the Theosophist, you could do all these various things. What's so compelling about Rosicrucianism that it continues through the centuries to promote people to do this? What's the essential thing, the essential problem that it solves? Why are they doing this?
Well, I think that everybody's looking for something.
But what does it provide that, what's the appeal of Rosicrucianism
per se? What's the appeal of it, rather?
Well, I don't know. Everybody comes to looking for something, and if they're not going to find it in Rosicrucians, they're going to find it elsewhere. You know, but you can't really generalize that, you know, that you're going to get A, B, or C from Rosicrucians.
Well, I would say, this is my take on it. I feel like the Rosicrucian stream current is quite old, as we're saying. You can pull it forward from antiquity, and that this is, and you guys bear with me here, this is the Christ or the Christ consciousness coming ever nearer to humanity, and that so this Rose Cross tradition, which is, some say it's not Christian, but I think it's very much embroiled or you know, contains the Christian energy, that as it approaches more so humanity, that it still maintains its relevance and it still maintains significance, because that stream is becoming more, that current is becoming stronger and more relevant as we approach the so-called Aquarian Age, and Christ consciousness will become more of an everyday experience for more humans on the planet as we move towards a more universal brotherhood system on this planet.
Let me throw out my idea, and
Please, before
Dionysus jumps in. Is that okay? Okay. Because I've noticed one similarity in a lot of these various rituals or texts or discussions, and that is the idea that the mind of the person going through some of these degrees is somehow that the obstructions are removed from the mind that allow the mind to progress to the higher life. In other words, there's a certain sense like things are thrown off.
Veils are removed,
obstructions are removed, and then that gives the person the capability, or at least opens the path then for them to go forward to some kind of higher life. I mean, more than Christianity, I would say like that idea permeates a lot of the Rosicrucian texts. So what do you think? I mean, is that totally off, or do you have like a different essential aspect to Rosicrucianism?
No, I would sort of...
You're trying to bite your tongue. Jump in there, man.
I'm tempted to reject the premise that the Rosicrucian current is strengthening. I think that it's certainly multiplying, but it's been
not in sheer numbers of like membership in a morgue and things of that nature.
No.
You know, I'm not trying to describe those terms.
But the organizational representations of it have multiplied, but I would say that in general, it's tended to get thinner. It's tended to become more compounded with other things. It was syncretic to begin with, but it's really
collecting accretions of more and more, and it's just being muddied downstream
to the point where there really aren't so many people for whom Rosicrucianism per se,
and I'm not
is
saying per
is
se,
their
I'm saying
ideal
that energy
and then well hmm. But I mean I don't know, I mean maybe I'm just losing the forest for the trees.
Also, well, okay.
I mean, because you've defined the energy in relation to this Christ consciousness business and so on, but that's
sure.
But that's your definition, and it looks very ad hoc from where I sit. I mean, I can't grasp the essence of what you're.
Well, that's why I wanted you to add your. That's why we have four.
Okay, well,
right.
E4.
Yeah.
And it might be that maybe it's just become such an ambiguous term that there is no essence that everyone can agree to.
Water down and generalize. Think about the terms karma, even Shangri-La, things like that, dharma. These are more watered down, everyday common terms in our day and age. And so Rosicrucian used to be, you know, so underground, and now You know, I meet so many people that say, oh, my relatives were involved with Rosicrucianism, and I used to think it was this, that, and the other, and you've really enlightened me as to what that truly is. And I've had a number of people, and especially with Masonry more so than anything, I've had so many people come up to me and say, well, my grandfather was a Mason, or this, that, and the other, and you guys have really opened my eyes as to the fact that not all Masons are into some nefarious cabal that they're trying to, you know, manipulate everyone else. So that's an educational process.
I think I can take a shot at your original question then.
Okay, great.
From my personal perspective, like what I find compelling about Rosicrucianism and what I see going on anywhere I see Rosicrucianism gets back to your point at the beginning about East and West, mm-hmm. about the union of complements. The Rosy Cross is a compound symbol. There's two pieces. There's a cross and a rose.
Very perceptive.
And so so whether it's the union of a subject and object in consciousness, or the union of Occidental and Oriental culture, or the union of masculine and feminine generating principles, I mean, all these unions of complements are sort of comprehended by the Rosicrucian symbol and can be carried by them in different contexts.
And they're all applicable.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to agree with that totally, because, in fact, Jung mentions this almost explicitly, like in his book Aeon, A-I-O-N, mm-hmm. and he describes it as the conjunctus. The conjunctus is like the union. And, in fact, he described it as the interpenetration of psychic opposites, the union of psychic opposites. But so there are these dichotomies, and so there's these two streams of social utopianism and then the practical.
Mm-hmm.
There,
right.
there do seem to be a lot of these opposites that are somehow like pulled together, a simultaneous coming together and pulling apart, solve and coagula, which brings the alchemy into the equation.
Mm-hmm.
And also the psychological component as well that's really become more emphasized, as you say, Jung. Wilhelm Reich, obviously, was somebody that delved into the more metaphysical aspects of psychology and the nature of the mind in relation to how the physical, like especially the sex function works, and how they came up with a lot of information. Why is it that all of Reich's books were burned, and why he was so much a pariah in the scientific community? I mean, he was kicked out by the communists. He was kicked out by everybody. He couldn't find a home with any group because his information was so ahead of the times and so poignant that you know, he was ostracized because he was so ahead of the curve. And I think that psychological component is much more emphasized in the way that the rituals have evolved, let's say for the Golden Dawn and other esoteric orders, that it's because humans evolve, and I would think that all of you would probably agree that we've evolved since, you know.
I'd have to say psycho-spiritual. I mean, I know it's kind of a cloudy word, but I would say, like a lot of people talk about the chakras as psycho-spiritual centers, and a lot of this kind of work is psycho-spiritual and just sort of the psychological, but not just therapeutic in the sense of, I've got, obsessive compulsive disorder, and so I go see a therapist, and they help solve that, and then I'm done. But almost something higher than that, where mm-hmm. it's like a psycho and spiritual.
Okay, so we're going to try to tap into the causative energy that's causing the disorder, the order, the dis-ease.
Well, just it acknowledges a higher order of spirituality in addition to the mundane psychological work that a therapist off the street might do.
So the also you talked about belief systems within like Rosicrucians and that. Within the Golden Dawn, like Masonry, there was no required religious document or book, but what it was, the members had to have a belief in a supreme being.
And that's mandatory across the board with Masonry.
And Masonry.
Anglo-American Masonry.
You're right. In France, it's different, mm-hmm. under the Grand Orient. Mm-hmm. But
and there are other continental jurisdictions that have...
But they're not recognized by the...
by the Anglo-American axis of regular Freemasonry.
And United Grand Lodge of England.
Right.
Right.
That's that being the head of the
pole. Yeah, the pole of the axis.
Okay, so that's...
But the... No, I think people brought different traditions, you know, from, Catholic, Christian, Muslim.
And that was unique for the time. I mean, in the same sense that we talked about Abra Melin, you know, having that unique aspect... I mean, this idea of universalism in religion, that was...
Yeah, and the Golden Dawn setup was pretty interesting from a religious perspective in that in the late 19th century, it was a... although you had a lot of interest in occultism, It was a very rationalist period, and a lot of people were pretty jaded towards conventional Christianity. And so with the Golden Dawn setup, you had an outer order that emphasized, you know, hermeticism and, like, pagan Egyptian gods and Kabbalistic concepts. And then once they got to the inner order, they discovered Christian symbolism. So it was a way of bringing people to spiritual truths that they wouldn't necessarily take if they were just offered straightforwardly. They had to be detoured around.
Right. The psychic sensor was somehow superpassed.
And I would say also the general interest in spiritualism at the time also, you know, people were trying to be rational about learning about the afterlife, and they were trying to think about it in not just heaven and hell terms. They were trying to rationally discern, you know, afterlife conditions and their approach to the beyond and things of that nature that fed into that as well.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there was Dionysus? You know a little bit about spiritualism of that time period. Do you think that spiritualism played into any of the Rosicrucianism of the 1800s?
Yeah, absolutely. One of the most successful spiritualist personalities who later renounced spiritualism and went for a more theosophical style occultism was Pascal Beverly Randolph. And he wrote a fictionalized autobiography called Ravelette or the Rosicrucian, and he founded a number of little Rosicrucian orders, which some of which survived him and later were perpetuated in other forms. I think the late 19th century occult tradition in England and America, in the English-speaking world particularly, it has a great debt to spiritualism, but in its early decades, it usually defined itself in opposition to spiritualism because the spiritualists were considered to be these sort of sloppy amateurs who would talk to any spirit and consider it to be worthy of their interest.
They would intercourse with anything.
That's right.
On the astral.
And certainly Randolph in Ravelette, you know, he's got a scene in the novel where the Rosicrucian magician does this parlor demonstration where he amazes people with all these standard spiritualist feats, and then he lets them see the spirit that's behind it, and it's this horrible little Cthulhu-like, you know, nasty thing. And and the idea being that, you know, the serious occultist will know what he's dealing with and have all the proper signs and symbols to acquire and control the communication that's desired.
Interesting point. And certainly we can touch upon the idea that the Theosophical Society also came in on the back of spiritualism and the Fox sisters up in the upstate New York area, and that basically they had to, definitely they came in opposition in many respects, as Dionysus was saying, but the popularity of it that they couldn't deny, so they had to, in order to gain popularity themselves, they had to kind of ride the coattails somewhat of the spiritualist movement and kind of quasi attach themselves with the popularity of people, again, being interested in the afterworld and the beyond and things of a metaphysical nature. So we saw that borrowing from that interest that was going on. And in this day and age, you have interest in psychics that's probably more popular than ever, and you even have television shows with your various respective psychics that are, and also law enforcement, you know, approaching psychics and what have you.
Well, spiritualism, I think, had a lot of negative press, a lot of negative connotation, because there was so much fraud within it. Just today, you know, when people refer to psychics, there's a lot of question as to how legitimate they are. I'm not saying that all are bad or all are good, but I think that you need to use discernment when dealing with that stuff.
Well, it's interesting. Edward Maitland, who was Anna Kingsford's collaborator, he wrote that he thought that there was something legitimate going on in spiritualism because sometimes spiritualists would fail. He said, if these were conjurers, they would never fail. Mm. If these guys were stage magicians, like, they'd have their tricks down, and it wouldn't be a problem. So obviously something is going on that these people are not entirely in control of, and so they're sincere, and, you know, they may be wrong about their phenomena, and then that would be the position taken by the later occultists, like Blavatsky and Randolph, and saying, well, you know, the phenomena are genuine, but the theory is wrong.
I kind of disagree with you because it was Harry Houdini, but before he died, he gave a password to his wife, and he said, any spiritualist or people that have contact with the dead can contact me if they're really true. and get the password. And if they did, I think, was there a money involved, a reward?
Well, it's definitely recognition with sure. that request.
Yeah, yeah. And no one's been able to do it.
Well, you can't really prove a negative. I mean, failure. So they just failed because they weren't very good or something. It doesn't mean...
Interesting points.
Or because Houdini's shade is obstreperous, you know, like he's right. got it in for them anyway, so it's like... Yeah.
You're speaking a little too esoterically for some folks. Yeah,
he
wouldn't come back from the dead to save his life.
Certainly not to vindicate a spiritualist.
Well, do you guys want to differentiate between lower psychism and higher psychism?
Well, this is interesting. Or? Yeah, I mean, let me throw one out. We talked about how masonry and the a lot of Rosicrucianism is perpetuated through a lot of the Masonic activity. And I guess my question is, did the magical Masons and somehow use Rosicrucianism as a way to lift the bar or standard? In other words, were they trying for some higher level of occultism than base spiritualism? Did that have anything to do with the perpetuation of Rosicrucian orders in the 1800s?
I think you see some of that in England. I mean, with the Golden Dawn.
And the SRI.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wouldn't generalize widely about it, but.
Okay. Okay, very interesting point. Let's see, where are we going to stir this guy now, you guys?
Did you want to go into some more kind of what was going on in America in the late 20s and 30s, or?
Well, I'd almost rather try to kind of, maybe if we can use that as a quick launch pad to pull it forward more so.
And yeah, you wanted to talk about a lot of the even modern, like right now.
Right, I would prefer to talk about what's going on right now, and why is it that we're sitting here talking, you know, obviously we're going to pay a lot of homage and give, you know, try to build the history and try to put it in that context and that perspective, but if we wouldn't be talking about this if it wasn't still applicable and practical at some level, and we wouldn't be devoting ourselves to various esoteric endeavors in our own lives if there wasn't some reason for that. And so that's what I want to kind of emphasize a bit, if I might, within each of our experience.
It certainly has taken on a life of its own. I mean, as a word, as a marketing term. I mean, but I guess that it keeps harking back to what is it about it now that attracts people and keeps the momentum going forward. Well,
I mean, is it that it attracts people? I mean, there are a certain number of groups that claim to be Rosicrucian, but the Golden Dawn, for example, isn't even one of those. I mean, the Golden Dawn, to the extent that it's promoted, it's esoteric orders in general. Okay.
And then also the whole New Age movement that's an another adjunct that kind of really branched out of theosophy, if you really want to look at it more in a more modern context.
Sure.
And that's a whole thing that, you know, that's not something that I really spent a lot of energy on, the so-called New Age aspects of this, but it does tie in. You find cross currents, again, from the New Age so-called, that tends to be a little bit more airy and fluffy and based on the crystals and things of that nature, oftentimes, that, you know, there tends to be somewhat of a different perspective.
Yeah, on the cross currents, this is just an anecdote that I shared before the show with you, but I thought it was worth mentioning again because it's when you have this a little Rosicrucian ritual group that's set up in the Theosophical Society around 1912, 1913, 2 or 3 years later, Ledbetter shut it down, but there were these Theosophical Rosicrucians in England, and they had their own little game going, and they kept it up for a few decades. And these were the people who formed some of Gerald Gardner's first recruits into his coven that was the basis of the modern Wiccan movement. So, I mean, at this point, I think a lot of people who know about Wicca and neo-paganism understand that, you know, maybe Gardner was involved with the OTO and Crowley, and so, like, there's some of the other cultist traditions at the back of that, but they don't see how fundamental even Rosicrucianism and Theosophy were in terms of the inspiration for the first participants.
Right, so what's become nature magic, Wicca, all those things that we think of along those lines. That's a lot of the neo-paganism, as you said, the revival of paganism. The number one religion in England is paganism, according to more recent statistics, and so that...
Wow, I'd be really interested in your source on that, if you could get it to me later.
It's a source I've came across within the last year, but okay. I don't know that I could recover it, in all honesty. But I feel, you know, don't have a problem saying that publicly.
No, but
so.
I'd like to know and be able to document it if it's
not
prevalent.
A problem. I'll see what I can do for you.
Also, Gardner was a member of the Woodcraft group that was which also influenced modern Wicca. It was a kind of a.
And when you say woodcraft, you're not talking about cabinet makers.
No. It's like Boy Scouts.
Yeah, Yeah, but it's an kind
adults
of too. Yeah, it's an adult
appreciation of nature and things mm-hmm. of that.
Yeah, and they had you know, ceremonies that, you know, very akin to what Gardner was teaching.
And they had a little radical wing, who were naturists, as well as being nature appreciators. There was a nudist wing of the woodcraft movement, and Gardner was involved with that.
So. Now there's still woodcraft people around.
Yes.
I think so.
What about eco-terrorism? Would you tie that in? Ultimately, can we tie that to the theosophy at some point, some level?
No. Well, no, I don't actually see how the woodcraft... I mean, woodcraft is definitely part of Wiccan origins, but I don't know. We seem to be strayed from the Rosicrucian thread.
But good point, though, nonetheless, that, you know, you can look at these bedrock institutions, theosophy and Rosicrucianism, as really the main body from which all these little tributaries and streams branched off, and still intertwine and interconnect at many levels, and still find themselves in, you know, modern society, applicable and practical in various groups.
So who are the modern proponents of, I mean, like right now, if someone was, wow, I'm interested in Rosicrucianism, I mean, who are the modern proponents of this?
The main guy, the one that's like the the McDonald's of Rosicrucianism is Amorc, A-M-O-R-C.
It's the ancient mystical order of the Rosy Cross. It's
right.
They originally came out of New York and then put their headquarters in San Jose, California.
True.
But there's also another group that was founded by Max Heindale in Oceanside, California. And then there is the climber group.
The Federation...
Quaker, Pennsylvania, I think, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Quakertown, Pennsylvania?
Well, that's where their headquarters is now.
Yeah. And then those are kind of sort of the ones that kind of go back in history, but then you got a lot of startup groups that have gone through their, like Amorc Rosicrucian, through their correspondence course, and...
Well, and there are still Masonic Rosicrucian groups of various kinds. There's a theory that Rosicrucianism was the actual origin of Freemasonry, and most of the high degree systems in Masonry touch on Rosicrucianism at some point or another.
Well, think about the degree that contains the pelican ripping
degree.
Into its own breast to feed the young pelican
That's
babies.
That's the Rosicrucian degree.
Yeah.
To me, personally, when I see that picture, it just evokes for me such a reverence.
State flag of Louisiana.
That's a good point as well.
That's a conspiracy.
Interesting symbolism that we're tapping back into. Again, the symbolism and the archetypes we find at the core of all these orders when you trace it back far enough. And so that's, again, the commonality is there if you really want to look at it in that respect. We talk about East-West, yin-yang, and all these things, but ultimately they all return to one initial energy, one impetus.
But the nice thing about symbols is they're polyvalent. They can mean many things. I mean, like, look at the rose. A rose in Rome literally meant a secrecy, so they would meet under a rose.
Right.
And so another way of looking at the rose and the cross is that these are truly esoteric in the sense that they're actually occult. They're actually hidden, and that's what maybe the rose means. I mean, I'm not saying that's true. I'm just saying that...
Well, also all the energy that's been built up, that's from, you know, the energy that was contained initially in these symbols and then through usage of these symbols over time and how it becomes ingrained in our consciousness more so that it even maintains more energy over time, I would say. And that's why I think esoteric, we can be more potent as esotericists in this day and age than we can, let's say, from the late 1800s and things of that nature, because the culmination of the stream is available to us and we have evolved from that time, so we can be much more potent in our various work.
Maybe. Or the other way. Maybe it's like, you know, it's become muddied and it's all so confused it's even harder to distill out the true essence.
The New Age has taken care of the distillation in many respects as far as that, from my perspective, and that's the more watered down for the masses, so to speak, as far as I would look at that. But you still have very potent esoteric orders, some more public than others, that are still doing good work behind the scenes. And it's hard to really say for sure what's what and who's who because a lot of these groups don't really publicize themselves. But nonetheless, if we look back and understand that the nature of a hierarchical system and how energy works and how everything culminates from one emanating energy, we can certainly understand and we'd have a hard time arguing against the fact that there are esoteric orders in existence that are doing really, again, potent work behind the scenes that are just not really accounted for in mainstream knowledge.
Yeah. I would say that just since the innovation of the internet, let's say just in the past 10 years,
absolutely.
The globalization of the world has opened
up part of it.
Opportunities that didn't exist in the 50s or the 60s. I mean, you'd have to get on an airplane and you'd travel somewhere. You know, there were books. You could read books.
There are so many esoteric
It used to
chat
be you would have to,
groups.
You know, traveling, you know, from Europe to Iran was a huge deal. You know, you'd
certainly
get these things, you'd come back and you'd be like, but now we have the opportunity to, you know, you've got the global culture.
My sister's been to Syria 3 times in the past couple of years.
So it's all much more possible now to have a universal sort of knowledge. But it also makes it harder just because it's all exponentially multiplied.
Very interesting. But if you do believe that there are masters, so-called, and not everybody's going to fall back on that concept that there are Christ in the church invisible, so-called, my belief is that the hierarchy was and is and will be, and that guiding group of individuals, or whatever term you want to apply to them, do still stand behind the scenes and guide the true esoteric orders and still allow them to maintain their body of work and still do the influential behind the scenes kind of things that they are always so well known for, or maybe not so well known for in some cases.
So does Rosicrucianism have this secret chief?
Without question, they all do. All true esoteric orders have
a
master behind them at some level.
Or maybe like 100 of them or something.
120?
120.
That's a nice, perfect round number.
I think that Rosicrucians, like, it's important maybe to read the original manifestos,
mm-hmm,
and, you know, interpret and understand them yourself.
And that's another thing, too. I think that we have the ability, we have access to all this information. We can use our own discernment in this day and age, and we have access to so much, and so much that was in private libraries and privately held has become public. So we have so much at our disposal. You know, we can become the potent esotericist because there's so much ground has been covered, and so much is available to us, so readily available, that we can do
our
own exploration. We
have huge libraries and spend all this money on books.
Well, and there's also the winnowing the wheat from the chaff is at least as difficult as it's ever been. I mean, there's
because there's so much.
It's more difficult.
I mean, Sturgeon's law does not stop applying just because all this stuff is available. It's
Sturgeon's law.
Sturgeon, 90% of everything is crap.
I'd up that a few degrees, but nonetheless. Yeah, good point. Very good point. But still, yes, you have to use your own discernment. That's what it boils down to with any people that have gone down this path in the past that have, I'm thinking about joining this Golden Dawn group. I know this lady, Anna Kingsford, she's starting this group. I'm thinking about becoming a member. You know, from that point, they had to have discernment and pull it forward. You know, if you're thinking about becoming a member of a Mason and you want to ask one to become one, you have to give that some serious consideration and consider, I would think that you would want to do that, and give it some serious consideration as to why you're expending your energy and why are you interested in this esoteric stream, what are you hoping to gain, and you know, things of that nature. What is your intent, ultimately?
Also, I think it's important to any group that you get involved in is be cautious of groups that charge large sums of money to be a member.
Right. Any monetary request, yeah. I would question at first, and then from that point go forward.
Lodge-based systems, you know, have material needs that they use money.
Right.
I mean, Masons have always charged dues.
Well, I know. But
again,
you know,
discern that
reason,
in your own
right.
heart.
Yeah.
As
you know,
to
like
why.
$5,000 for initiation, or you know,
certainly. Yeah.
You know,
well, and the name, these names like Rosicrucianism. You know, the name carries a lot of mystique. But, you know, I was about 15 years ago. Somebody, I had a conversation with somebody about a magical order that he was involved in, and it had a very famous name and everything. And I really didn't care so much about whether it was entitled to that name. What I was interested in hearing from him was, like, what kind of work is being done? How is it valuable to you?
Right. That's always my interest. What is the cause behind the outer effect,
mm-hmm,
and what's really the intent behind that effort? But that's always my question, too, because that's where you're going to find, you know, the meat of the matter. When you get back to the originating cause, that's the effort of, that's the path of the esotericist, is to get on the path of return to the origin of our emanation and to understand that more fully, understand ourselves as humans more fully, and to be able to be more capable components of humanity and to serve our fellow men universally, hopefully. And we're gonna have to wrap up here very briefly here, you guys. So.
Well, maybe I have room for one comment.
Yes.
I think it is important that everyone use their own discernment, and
mm-hmm,
I think it's
sure.
important that you do your own paperwork and read the original things. I agree with all this, but hopefully if you join a group, someone there will be able to, you know, point you in the right direction. In other words, you won't have to, if you have to completely reinvent the wheel now, you've got a lot of languages to learn, you've got a lot of books to read.
Right.
Hopefully, one of the benefits of joining a good group would be that they would point you at the right stuff.
I would hope so. All right, well, Omerga,
thank you so much.
Darcy, Dionysis, really appreciate it. And
thank
certainly we'll be continuing this esoteric forum within the various shows myself. Our show here at Esoteric Science Roundtable, and therefore I will be continuing this. I do want to remind everybody about the Freedom Jam, so-called, that's going to be tomorrow in Kerrville from 9 to 9. And want to thank everybody for taking the time to view our show this evening. I want to thank my producer, Chris, for commanding the helm of the Starship Esoterica. And I want to thank everybody in Austin. Thanks, you guys. Have a nice evening. Take care.